you join the dance? Will you, won't you, will you, won't you, won't you join the dance?
Hello and welcome, everyone, to the Lewis Carroll Society of North America's very special presentation, A Wonderland of Data Visualization. And that will be presented by Richard Brath. My name is Heather, and I am the proud chairwoman of your senior common room curators. That's the ladies who bring you these virtual events every single month, which in 2022, we're gonna slow the roll just a little bit, although hopefully you noticed in that slideshow, we do have events lined up in February, February 12th. We have a pre-Valentine's Day party. That's gonna be a great time. Dana Noon is going to show us some of her Flat Alice collection of Valentines. And we have some other surprises cooked up for you as well. And then I think this is breaking news. I believe this is the first time the spring meeting dates have been publicized. And that will be Friday, April 22nd and Saturday, April 23rd, hosted by our friends at USC. And they of course also host the vast, wonderful Cassidy collection over there. Now, before we get started, I wanted to give everyone just a minute or two. If you are watching on a really small device, like a tablet or horrors, a phone, I would very much recommend that you log out and go get yourself a bigger screen, because there are so many little details in this wonderful slideshow today that Richard is going to show you. You do not want to miss anything. And I really think definitely on a phone, you're going to miss most of it. And even on a tablet, you could have some issues seeing the smaller details. So I would highly recommend switching over to a big device. And I'm even going to vamp a little longer than usual to give you a chance to do that. If you're looking behind me, this is my idea of data visualization. This is a March Madness bracket I did last year for my website, Alice is Everywhere. And I had people on Instagram and Facebook vote on their favorite March hares. And I think we knew, can you see there? Of course, it was gonna come down to 1951 Disney and John Tenniel. I mean, how could it go any differently? But I was really curious to see how the early rounds went. First round, we had, of course, 1951 Disney trounced 2010 Disney. That was no surprise, 79% to 21%. There was a theme in that more modern illustrators won out over kind of old classics here, as you see with Ladislav Erko and Arthur Rackman. This one was interesting to me because Camille Rose Garcia just has so many huge fans, but I think she's also kind of a love it or hate it kind of illustrators, and Allison J eked out a win over her in round one. And then this was a very tight race, Robert Ingpen against Mervyn Peake, and again, the more modern illustrator won out. And I'll be honest with you, I wasn't actually familiar with, I don't know how to say his first name, so I'm going to say Mr. or Mrs. Basic there, but I just came across it and I loved it. And as you can see, he won out over Barry Moser quite handily. And then I believe this is the last one, Elizabeth Zwerger and John Vernon Lord. She remained victorious there. And then Tenniel, you know, Gwynedd Hudson, did she really have a chance? I don't think so. By the way, if you have tuned in late and you're wondering, wait, is this the presentation? No, this is like the pre-show. This is like the newsreel. I wanted to give everyone a chance to go log on to a big device. Go to your smart TV, go to your computer with the biggest monitor, because Richard Brath's presentation today has some beautiful slides with lots of little details. And you're not going to want to watch on a small device if you can possibly help it. So I'm just killing some time here, showing you the very important results of March Madness last year. So the next round, Disney against Allison J. Again, Disney, it's gonna come out on top. It's a lot of people's first introduction to Alice, 84% to 16%. Mr. or Mrs. Basic again won out of it against Robert Ingpen. Erko against Jan. Oh, you know what? I think we skipped a round. Yeah, Jan Svankmajer really beat out Roddy McDowall in that 80s TV movie. And John Tenniel, ooh, That's a big margin against Lisbeth's worker, but how are you going to go up against the OG? Final four time. Disney beats out Mr. Basic. Tennille beats out Vladislav Erko. And here it is. Who was the big winner? Close, but not that close, right? So yeah, I had a lot of fun with that last year.
And now, you know what?
I think we're ready to get started. So this presentation that you're going to see today is all about data visualization. Richard Brath is an expert in this, and he knows how academics do it, right? Like, he's been doing it for a long time, and he decided, you know what, I'm going to see how other people do it, designers, artists. And for his experiment, he chose your favorite book and mine, or maybe your second favorite book, if the results of our great debate last year, Looking Glass versus Alice's Adventures in Wonderland, is any indication. But he used Alice's Adventures in Wonderland to go seek out all these different data visualizations. And let me tell you a little bit more about Mr. Brath. Professionally, I just lost my place. He is one of the partners of Uncharted Software, Inc. He has recently completed a part-time PhD in data visualization at LSBU. He has authored two books on data visualization, Graph Analysis and Visualization, together with David Yonker, and Visualizing with Text. Everyone, please welcome Richard Brath. Thank you for being here, Richard.
Thank you very much. Hello, everyone. I'm honored to be presenting here today at the Lewis Carroll Society. Thanks for having me. I hope you're all doing well during Omicron, and perhaps it's maybe even helped boost attendance today. So I'll be talking about a wonderland of data visualization, or as I'll call it, what can we learn from 64 data visualizations of Alice in Wonderland? Anyways, who am I? I'm Richard Brath. Thanks very much. By day, I create data visualizations. I do this for giant corporations and little startups. You can see a couple examples on the left side there. I'm also very interested in text and how text can work together with visualization. So I did a PhD about this, and then I wrote a book that came out last year. A few bits of what I'm talking about today will be related to things from the book as well. So, Why am I doing this? Why are we looking at Alice in particular? And what's our motivation for visualizing Wonderland? So let's back up a bit and introduce data visualization. Maybe not everybody here is familiar with this world of data visualization, but it's something that we look at and we use data visualizations every day. So we've got data on the left side of this slide here, right? And it's just tables of numbers. It can be pretty boring. And on the right side, we can make these visual representations that help us see patterns and relationships in the data. So,
Richard, you're actually not sharing your screen. Yeah.
Oh, we're actually doing this correctly. Okay, so.
Perfect. Looks good.
Let's try again. All right. So, what can we learn from data visualizations? Who am I? Here are a couple of snapshots of things that I've done professionally on the left, and a little snapshot of my book on the right. And why are we doing data visualizations? So backing up, here are some examples of data visualizations. And on the left, we have the data. And the data is just represented in tabular form, and it's not particularly interesting. And on the right are the visualizations of that. And on the visualizations, you can start to see patterns and relationships in the data. So for example, in the election data that we see, Biden wins on the West Coast and he wins in the Rust Belt, for example. Or in the lower image, we see some relationships between birth rates and death rates in different countries in a rather strange shape that's resulting in the data there. So there are lots and lots of different ways to do data visualizations, a great variety of them. And here are just a few examples from a toolkit called D3JS by Mike Bostock. And so there are, you know, many, many techniques available to create these data visualizations. So then what happens when we shift and we go and we start with text as your data? So the simple answer is that you just count the words in your text, and that's your data. And once you have data, you can visualize it using any of those techniques that you saw just a few slides ago. And then here's perhaps the most famous example of text visualization. This is called a word cloud. Presumably everybody has seen word clouds. The size of the text in the word cloud corresponds to how often it occurs in the text. And then there's color in that word cloud. And the color actually doesn't correspond to data at all. It's just arbitrary. And the position, well, actually the position is just arbitrary as well. It's about making the text fit. And the angle of the text, well, actually that's just arbitrary too. So even though this is a visualization and it's visually engaging, it doesn't really tell us very much about the text. So we can look at collections and see, you know, just like those other tools that we had for data visualization, are there a great variety of visualizations for text visualization? And this is a snapshot from an academic site that collects a few hundred different text visualizations from academic researchers. And you may notice a couple of things here, right? Many of these visualizations look like those data visualizations we saw two slides ago. And many of these visualizations here actually don't even have text in them or have very little text in them, even though they're about text. So that leaves me a little bit suspicious that the community of researchers that I work with might be missing some opportunities that could be happening with visualization. There's got to be more text visualization than just doing the same thing as data visualization. And so why should we care about that? Why do we even care about that? Well, we care about that because it'll give us new ways to look at literature. It will also be important because text is a basic communication tool that we all use. And language and text is being hijacked by various groups who want to disrupt society today. This is becoming a major issue with things like fake news and scams and phishing and trolls and disinformation campaigns. And these are big problems. We need better ways to analyze and understand what's being communicated to help understand what's going on in some of these campaigns. So if we then take that text visualization is important, how are we gonna do that? How are we gonna find different ways of visualizing text? How are we gonna discover some new techniques? So we wanna find a lot of different visualizations. And here's an interesting example. The Titanic sank more than 100 years ago now. And the data from the Titanic has been widely published. So Michael Friendly, Jürgen Szymanczyk, and Ortak Under decided to track down all the different visualizations that they could find of the Titanic data. And surprisingly, they found 24 very, very different visualizations. Here's a few of them on the slide. And as another example, this is from a person named Jacques Bertin. He's one of the founders of the way that we think about visualization back in the 1960s. And he used a similar approach too. He picked a singular data set and then he showed how he could visualize it 90 different ways. And the idea here is that different visualizations are going to reveal different relationships in the data. So you can see there's a whole bunch of little maps of France over here on the right. You know, here's one, if you can see my mouse with a big spike in Paris, a lot of dots that are occurring there. Here's one where there's a really broad pattern of yellow across the western half of France that's very obvious. Here's another one where some red patterns across the northeast of France become a little bit more obvious. And then we've got other plots here showing, you know, correlations between variables. And so the small data set has lots of different representations. And the idea is that different visualizations are going to reveal different things about the data. So that's the reason why we want to have a lot of different visualizations. So how are we going to do this for text? Well, we're going to pick a single data set, and then we're going to find or make lots of variations, just like those previous two examples. But which text are we going to use for this? We want something with wide popularity. So we're probably not going to use something like the Outline of European Architecture. Sorry, Nicholas Pevsner. We want something that's going to appeal to lots of different communities. So we're probably not going to narrow in on sci-fi like Larry Niven's fabulous Ringworld. And we're probably not going to use the Divine Comedy because that doesn't really reach out to a lot of different age groups very well. Now, we also probably want something that's been around for a long time. And that's partially because we don't want to run foul of, say, any copyright issues when we're dealing with the text. So J.K. Rowling, That's out. And we probably want to stay away from an analysis of a text that, perhaps is very important to some people and might be considered offensive, the kinds of things that we do. So we will focus on Alice in Wonderland. And I think that was actually really a foregone conclusion. What I went through was just a post-rationalization, because actually I just wanted to use Alice in Wonderland all along because it's well known. It's got wonderful wordplay and other literary techniques in it. So let's move on. Let's actually take a look at some visualizations. Now that we've set the stage, what are the kinds of visualizations that we can find? So I went out and looked on the internet and looked at what some different researchers are doing at different universities. And so within the visualization community and within the humanities community, here are 10 different visualizations of the text from Alice in Wonderland. And we've got 64 different visualizations. So I'm not going to be able to go through each one. It's just going to be far too much time. So we'll just go through a couple of highlights in here. On the left side, we have some visualizations from the visualization community. This technique with the number one is a technique called a word tree that shows the repetition of words. And as they break down into different sentences, you can see other things in here as well. These tools in the middle are text analysis tools. And on the right, this is a thesis from an English major that has gone through a detailed analysis of Alice. I will focus on a couple in particular. And so from the data visualization community, this is an example that is now 20 years old, made by Brad Paley and his team there. It's a wonderful early interactive visualization. And a couple of quick things about it is around the outside here, you can't read it. It's super tiny, but all of the text is around the perimeter of this visualization. And for example, you can even see the mouse's tail right there in the super tiny text. And then stepping in from there, we've got the words that are being used in Alice in Wonderland. And if the word is used multiple times, it gets bigger. And the biggest words you can then see are the characters in a lot of cases. And the characters are positioned relative to where they occur in the text. So the queen occurs late in the story, so she's over here in the tail end of the text, as well as the king. The mouse is over early in the text. The rabbit is near the middle because the rabbit occurs in many different parts of the text. So it's a wonderful early visualization that's out there. There are other communities in the sciences that are using Alice's text as well and creating different kinds of visualizations. So there's an area called natural language processing, and it uses statistical techniques and computational techniques to analyze text. And sometimes that community likes to use Alice for testing their software and explaining some of the things that they're doing. And so you can see some of the visuals that they create. On the left, you can see how sentences and phrases are deconstructed by computers, extracting things like nouns, verbs, and phrases, and so forth. And then in the center, we can see other things like keyword extraction, topics, social network metrics, word neighborhoods, and so forth. This one here that I've enlarged is doing emotion analysis. So statistically, certain words are associated with certain emotions. For example, the word love is associated with the emotion joy, or the word battle is associated with the emotion anger. And so you can compute that across the book. And then, for instance, anger here, you can see in this red line, the red line peaks about two-thirds of the way through the book. And that probably roughly corresponds to where the Queen of Hearts croquet game is occurring. On the fine arts and computer graphics side, there are people who have far more expressive representations in the visualizations they create. I love all of the examples on the slide, and I don't have time to go into all of them. I will point just at a couple here. On the left side, this is a fine art thesis by Yi Chia Cheng, where she converted Alice, portions of the Alice text into the underlying sounds. And then she piled up those sounds into distributions. And so you can get a sense of how Alice sounds. And then she can do that on a per language basis and compare how Alice sounds in Russian or Portuguese or many other different languages, which is a pretty interesting thing to try to do. This one that I've just enlarged here, this is a technique called micrography. And essentially, it's the process of taking text and making it fit inside of arbitrary shapes. And so if we back up even just 30, 40 years ago, this is a very difficult thing to do when your text is made out of metal and trying to position all of it and make things fit. this creative computer graphics programmer, Ron Maharik, actually figured out how to automate this whole thing. And then as one of the examples, he put Alice in Wonderland into these shapes and then color coded them. And we've got this incredible flowing pattern here. So I think this is actually a really interesting way to consider, gee, you know, what would happen if we had a nonlinear reading of Alice, and what might have Carol have done if he had a tool like this available? The previous examples that I showed were kind of in research universities. I want to move outside of that because there's lots of examples of people doing things that aren't related to research. We'll call that in the wild, what happens in the wild. And this slide here shows people in the wild who are trying to extract data from the text. So for example, we know that Alice shrinks and grows. So you can collect that as data, and then you can plot that as a line chart, for example. That would be one of the things. And so there's other things with timelines and height charts in here. I like this one in particular. You can see it's just, we've got the chapters across the bottom and the height of Alice along the side here. And then we've got different sized Alices in here that correspond to her height in the story. But that quantitative data is also combined with this commentary here. And these annotations are a Freudian analysis of size as a metaphor for Alice's adolescent transition between childhood and adulthood. So I think that's a really interesting juxtaposition between quantitative numeric data and critical analysis being combined into one chart. So many more examples are out there in the wild. There are interactive examples that people create for young children in learning, pop-ups and lift the flap type things. And then there's things where people extract the characters and make lists of characters or connections between characters. And in this one, I'm going to focus on this example here. This is a character map. So it's showing the different characters from Alice using Tenniel's illustrations. And then we've got arrows connecting the characters to show the relationship between them. And then a little bit of text telling you about the relationship between the two characters. And so what's really interesting for me about this one is this actually comes from a costume website, a website that sells costumes for costume parties. And if you think about it, it's actually really handy. Like if you're going to go to a costume party to have like some kind of nice, handy little synopsis that tells you what your relationship is to the other characters so you know what to say when you go up and talk to them. So completely out of the world of, you know, not the researchers, but super useful kind of visualization. And then there's visualizations that go and look at longer spans of text, looking at themes and looking at plot and structure and so forth. And so those can be things like bar charts and ring charts and so forth. I do really like the plot diagrams. And in particular here, I'm going to highlight this homework assignment by Cyrena Thompson. And I think it's wonderful that you can find these kinds of things on the web, right? So when you hand draw your analysis, it means there's a bunch of things that you can do with the text. So rising action, you can like just turn the text and make it rising, and falling action is like, it's just like falling down there. And you can make the text fit and line up and do all kinds of wonderful things there when you're not constrained to computer drawing tools to make these things. And then at the other extreme, you can go to some really exquisite book editions of Alice. So on the left there, we have Yayoi Kusama and Stephanie Posevic's edition of Alice, where the typography mirrors what's going on in Alice's world. So we have labels on items like the rabbit's nameplate and the drink me label are like they're engraved. So they're all caps. And an italic there. And then on the right side, you can see, you know, Alice is growing. So the text is getting really big and just barely fit on the page. So that was 47 different visualizations scattered across those slides that we just went through. What do we get out of that? Well, we can count up and look at the different techniques that we have there. We can make a few different observations. And so for example, how text is used is very different by these different communities. So the visualization people tend to use text as labels. They tend to just use a word or two at a time in their visualizations. And the statistical people, oftentimes they don't even use words at all in their visualizations, are very minimal. Whereas the artists, they'll take whole chunks of text out of Alice, phrases and sentences and paragraphs and manipulate those in what they're creating. And in the wild, what we find is a lot of abstractive use of text. That basically means that they're creating little synopses of the text and using that in what they've created. On the other side here, we have how do they visually represent data in what they're creating. And the one thing that I'll just point out here is that once we get to in the wild, we see a lot of typographic effects coming into play. So people are using things like bold and italics and capitalization and so forth in things that they're working with. So we're only at 47 and I promised 64. So we've got more visualizations to go through. Here's 17 visualizations that I made that are inspired by the possibilities implied on the previous slide. So we're moving into some different territory for some different visualizations here. Hopefully everybody can still hear me okay and it's all going okay.
Yes, sir, we can hear everything.
Okay, awesome. So let's start really small. Let's start at the level of smaller than a word. And on the left side, we're looking at words that Lewis Carroll made up and then just indicating the letters that Carroll added or deleted on there. On the right side, what we're doing is showing the musical qualities of text. So when you take music and you put it into a prose text format, all the musical qualities are lost. And so here we can see that the deeper notes are heavier text, and then the higher notes are lighter and higher on the page, literally. And then we have things like the rhyming part of the word is in red, and the actual words that Carroll actually changed are highlighted in yellow, and we actually changed very few of the words is what we see here. When we move to the level of words, that means we can focus on individual words, and that's really easy then to start focusing on characters. When we focus on characters, there's so much that we can extract out of the text when we're using these computational techniques and then create visualizations based on these things that we extract from the text. And there are many of them. I'm just going to focus on this one at the bottom left here. And this is character sentiment. So basically we can take the character, look at the words around the character, and then those words have statistical associations with them. Negative, some words are negative, some words are positive. And so then we see the griffin is leaning very far left. The griffin has a lot of negative words associated with the griffin. And over on the words sloping to the far right, we have duchess and puppy. And so there's a lot of positive words, exceedingly large number of positive words associated with the puppy, almost falling over to the right here. We can start to look at words and start showing some of those other words around the words as well. So in this visualization at the bottom, what we have here are the characters from Aleph, and then these are the adverbs that occur associated with those characters. So for example, we see the word timid. Lewis Carroll describes Alice very frequently when she's talking, that she's saying things timidly. But she's also saying things politely and eagerly and hastily and so forth. If we look at the queen, we get words like furiously, triumphantly, and severely. We're getting words that are a little more tense and perhaps violent or angry words in there. The rabbit, we see words like suddenly and violently and slowly. So the rabbit's got a lot of words that are around kind of timing associated with him. And then the hatter, we've got words like dreadfully, mournfully, contemptuously. So the hatter is not coming across, at least as he's described, as a pleasant character. So here's another one. This is a fun one. And this one is a bit like a puzzle. There's a lot of things going on in here. So again, hopefully you see my mouse. At the top here, we have all of the characters listed that talk, and they are listed in order of how much they talk. So most of the dialogue that we have is from Alice directly, and the eaglet says very, very little. But we also have things like color and font weight going on in here. So the font weight is indicating who's the most talkative. That's what we see in the ordering that we have there and here. And then all of the other formats are actually things about the popularity of the characters based on their statistics from Wikipedia. So the characters that are most viewed on Wikipedia are in a wide font. So we've got the rabbit, the cat, Alice, those are the ones who have the most popular, most viewed pages. The ones that have the longest Wikipedia pages are in capitals. So we've got Alice the Cat, the Hatter, so forth, are the longest pages that we have. And the most edited Wikipedia pages are the darkest color. So we've got the Cat, the Hatter, the Heart, Queen of Hearts, and so forth. And so we've got all of these jumbles of different formats, and like the ordering is completely different in each of these. And so what does this tell us? It's telling us really quite simply that the amount that a character speaks is not related to their popularity. In fact, if we look here, Queen of Hearts is quite far down the list in terms of how much she talks, and she's up quite far in the list here. The King of Hearts, the Mouse, the Griffin, they're all near the top in terms of how much they talk, but they don't even make the Wikipedia lists at all. And in fact, right up at the top here, we can see the Cheshire Cat, right? Like the Cheshire Cat is way down the list here, probably number 10 or 12 in terms of speaking, and it's all caps, it's dark colored, it's really spaced out with a wide font. Now, Cheshire Cat is at the top of the list for all the Wikipedia statistics. So let's move along. Let's start looking at some word sequences. And here we've got some techniques looking for repetition in words. Looking at the lower image, what we're doing is we're highlighting repeated words and then connecting those repetitions where they occur in the text. And this portion of text is from the Mad Tea Party. And so what you can see here is that it's actually madly interconnected with repeated words all over the place throughout the Mad Tea Party. We might even say perhaps that they're all saying the same thing. And we can change the order and do other kinds of orderings. We don't need to just stay in normal paragraph layouts. So we can do other things there. And then we'll start moving a little bit bigger in scope again. So now we've got all of the chapters listed on this one, and we're looking at emotions associated with the chapters. So we're using that same statistical technique that we talked about maybe 15 minutes ago. And here we have each chapter. We have a bar for each chapter, and the color for each chapter is the top emotion. And by far the chapter with the most differentiated emotion is Pig and Pepper. It's a very disgusting chapter, at least statistically it is that way. And we can see, for instance, the chapter 4 where Rabbit sends in Little Bill, that is an anticipation chapter. And the Queen is associated with anger, as we might expect in chapter 8. So let's move on. We've just got a few examples left here and then we'll wrap up. We're going bigger and bigger. This is all the dialogue from Alice, or most of the dialogue from Alice. It doesn't quite all fit on one page here. And what we have is the dialogue from one character on the left side here to another character shown across the top here. And so then each square corresponds to text, say in this case, from Alice to the Duchess. And so we have, you know, all the things that Alice is saying to the Duchess. And furthermore, we can automate highlighting some common sets of words. Essentially, what I'm doing here is just looking for at least two repeated words, one of which has to be an uncommon word, so we don't get things like of the or in the, things like that. So we're looking for one uncommon word in there in a span of five words. And we start to get out phrases like Alice repeating over and over again, "I didn't know that, I didn't know that, I don't know any of that." And that's not just the Duchess who she says that to, she's also saying that to the Hare and to the Queen and to some other characters as well. So the reason why I did this was that I thought that, Carol inverts words in some of the things that he's doing, right? So we should use that technique and be able to get things out like "I see what I eat" and "I eat what I see" pops out. So we can start to find some of those inversions that he did. What it turned out to be really good at was finding catchphrases and variations of catchphrases. So when we look at the Queen, what we get out of that is "off with her head," "off are their heads off," "off with his head," "your head must be off," and so on. So we have a certain preoccupation with headlessness that becomes very obvious when we highlight that. Last two, this is just an example where we take the entire text of Alice when we're completely zoomed out. We create some landmarks by picking some words out of the paragraphs and making those large. So in the latter part of the book, we can see some words popping out here about the Griffin. So Griffin waiting, Griffin sighing, Griffin yawning. Griffin seems to be a little impatient, perhaps. And then as one final example here, this is number 64, and this is the entire text of Alice again. In this example, I went to the internet and I found 200 quotations of Alice. There's lots of websites that will give you quotations from Alice or from any other book. So I went and found 200 quotations. I want to see what was the commonality. What are the kinds of things that people are pulling up from Alice? So basically I then take the entire document of Alice and each time I find one of those quotations, I increase the font size by just 1 point. So if a quotation gets quoted more, the point size goes up and up. So right at the beginning of the book, we see what is the use of a book without pictures or conversations. That's a little bit bigger than the surrounding text. And then curiouser and curiouser is bigger than that. Who in the world am I? That's a great puzzle, is bigger yet. And the largest overall, if you've got a good screen, you can read it. It says, we are all mad here. And furthermore, we have all the context visible. So in fact, much of the conversation between Alice and the Cheshire Cat is heavily quoted on the internet. So what? So what does all this mean? Do we get any insights out of this beyond each of the individual insights? Can we put that together in some way? I borrowed Heather's March Madness visualization here. This is called a bracket chart, and didn't quite do the same thing, but said, what were some of the characters that we saw stand out here in the last 20 minutes or so? And certainly we saw the puppy was leaning almost off the chart there. So we've got the puppy stood out. We certainly had the Cheshire Cat stand out in terms of Wikipedia popularity right at the top there. In terms of emotion, the pig clearly stood out as a winner in terms of disgustingness. And then finally, the cat comes back with madness. So I think from my perspective, we're going to give it to the cat. But we'll do one last slide here, perhaps a little bit more seriously. What else have we learned here? And that is from the Alice text, there's things that we were able to extract, like Alice is timid, the turtle is deep, the hatter is dreadful, pig and pepper is disgusting, the lobster quadrille is joyful. It's nice to find out. From Alice augmented by the internet, with internet data, we see the Cheshire Cat is incredibly popular, whether by page stats or by quotations. From Alice directly, we see that she repeats things like, I know, I don't know, I don't know. So the importance of questioning knowledge is really important for Alice. And I think from a visualization perspective, what we learned then is the importance of questioning visualization. And I think we need to be more critical of the ways that we make visualizations, and we need to be more critical of those computational tools that we use for analyzing text. And that's it. Thank you very much. If you were interested in any of those little snapshots that went floating past very quickly, you can find citations for all of them that are clickable on my blog. There's lots of posts on my blog, so you can just hit my blog site and then search for Alice and you'll get the post that has all of the links on it. And so thank you very much.
Thank you, Richard. Wow. Sometimes for our monthly events, we watch movies and we just all chat on the screen there. And I feel like we need to do that with your presentation here, because I know I had so many comments I was just saying to the screen as you were talking. I think that would be a really fun thing. Like your point about the Cheshire Cat. Yeah, he's so economical with his words, but he's brilliant. That's why he's quoted so much, right? Fascinating. Yes.
And an inverse relationship.
Absolutely. I just lost my screen there. Let's see. So audience questions. Let's see here. Well, here's one from Stephen Fullen. Fabulous and interesting subject and well presented. Have you or anyone used such visualizations to compare across books or across similar books by the same author? For example, Alice in Wonderland versus Through the Looking Glass.
So short answer, no, at least not for looking at Alice versus Alice. There are some other examples in the book and when I was doing my thesis that I did look at a little bit more. And so if I can easily find it here, I can do a quick little share.
Absolutely.
Which I thought I had up and running. Here it is.
And by the way, everyone asking for Richard's blog again, I can put it in the chat, but also if you go to our website, we have a link to it there, just lewiscarroll.org/events. We link to Richard's peer-reviewed research paper and also his website.
Yep. Wasn't these ones that I wanted. So we did the analysis of the adjectives.
Are you, we don't see your screen.
I'm sharing. So let me share the screen again. I keep forgetting. No, I need to click this button here. Here it is.
You always have to say, yes, I really mean it.
Yes. Okay. So we looked at the use of adverbs in Lewis Carroll, right? And I did that for a number of different texts. Mostly I had done it using adjectives. And the interesting thing was when I did adjectives in Lewis Carroll, not a lot actually really came out very interesting from that until I went back and looked at it again and realized that Carroll used a lot of adverbs. So it was a technique that I originally started with adjectives. And so here's a number of different books that we look at with adjectives. And so if we look at Grimm's fairy tales, for example, we see that, you know, princesses are beautiful and young and dear, whereas, you know, we've got children, child little and poor, and so forth coming through. And then we can look at other books in here as well. So what do we get for The Wizard of Oz? And then it will take a few minutes to calculate. So there were a few things like that I did look at.
I love that you had an answer. Of course, here, let me show you. Here's how I did that. And I find that so interesting that Lewis Carroll's all about the adverbs. That's fascinating. And also that slowly came up for the White Rabbit. So we know he's very harried. He's in a hurry. So that's kind of another one of those inverse, maybe opposite.
Yes, exactly.
All right. Let's see. And you know, you can keep sharing. Share your screen if you want. If anyone has any more questions about specific. Let's see. As we've heard, this is from Alan Tannenbaum. Carroll and his works are the third most quoted source after the Bible and Shakespeare. Have you seen any analysis to bolster that notion? If not, it sounds like a great project for you.
No, that was actually one of the very late ones. One of the most recent ones that I did was looking at the quotations, and scraping data from the quotation websites is not always easy. So scraping data off the web is a painful process sometimes. And then there's a second level of problem on there, and that is people misquote Alice in Wonderland as well. So I said I took 200 quotations. I think I got a match on about 157 or so. So, you know, some of them are like, you've got the wrong book. you're saying Alice in Wonderland, but it's through the looking glass, or like you've completely mangled it in some cases and so on. So no, I haven't done it. And that gets back to one of the challenges of just processing text, is that there can be challenges when you process text, and it's not always as simple and as easy as you hope it would be.
Yeah, misquotes are a real favorite, maybe not favorite topic of this group, but a real picadillo of this group. Yeah, I forget, but was it coins or stamps that just came out in England this year that had misquotes on them in honor of Alice in Wonderland? And some of them, a lot of them actually come from the movies, but yeah, there's a few I just have no idea where they come from. And in fact, I'm going to go off on a tiny tangent here. If anyone knows, I've seen this over and over again, Alice asking the White Rabbit, how long is forever? And the rabbit says, sometimes just a second. If anyone has any idea where in the world that came from, I would love to know, because that is just a bizarre misquote. Here's a question from Robert Steck. Have any Carolian scholars used these techniques? Have they commented upon the utility of these techniques? And actually, Robert, maybe if you're coming to our social hour, which there will be a social hour after this, you can ask the Carolian scholars present. I would love to hear that as well. Richard, I don't know if you have any thoughts on that.
I don't have an answer for you on that. I can say there was the one example that I looked at where in the humanities, there are some point and click tools. So the things that I'm doing, and a lot of what other people are doing, require programming or require a fair bit of effort to create. And so if you're a literature scholar, perhaps programming isn't your forte. And so There's still a challenge where there is a dearth of tools available for doing this in a point and click way. And if I go back to my screen share and remember to press the button. So these are two snapshots here of tools that are point and click tools for doing textual analysis. And this one here is called Juxta. And this one here is, I've now forgotten the name of this one, but I can, Voyant, V-O-Y-A-N-T. And so these are tools here. These are snapshots of them. These are snapshots of people actually looking at the Alice text. I would have to go back to these actual links to see if there was actually like a longer analysis that they were doing, or perhaps it was just a tutorial or just a passing snapshot.
Excellent. I have two related questions here. Bernadine asked, do nonsense words confuse the computer or whatever program you're using? And then Matt DeMacos related just basically says, how do you trust the computer to really know what an adjective is or an adverb? Like, does there always have to be a double checking human hand involved?
So computers are getting better and better at working with text, but computers still keep making mistakes when they're working with text. So both answers are relevant. Made up words, of course, won't necessarily exist in the corpus that the language that the computer understands that it's been trained with. And so it might trip up on some of those words and perhaps just ignore them, for example. You could also run into issues, for example, if I'm just looking for, say, adjectives around the cat. Well, that could be Dinah, or that could be the Cheshire cat, right? So there's a little bit of human knowledge perhaps required there to make sure we know which cat is being talked about when a cat is referred to. And so computers are getting better at doing that one, but that would be an example of something that would be difficult for the computer to today with best practices. I'm not really a deep computer programmer in terms of language processing. So I'm just using the tools that are available and the simple tools that are available today, even from a programming language, you would need to check and validate those. And they also make errors with the simple tools about, a word could be an adjective or it could be a noun and its use in the particular context, it could get not get quite the right meaning for the semantic meaning for that word and so on. And so, yes, I think in the near term, we need to be careful with those kinds of things. But even in the long term, for anybody who's out there and seen the abilities, it was massive on the internet last year of the quality of text that some of these new techniques can create. They can generate things that sound like real human written text. We're gonna need really good ways of inspecting that text to be able to disambiguate of like when somebody's just trying to make up some fake text and just having a computer program it versus like a real scholar creating text. So we're going to need better ways to do that.
Actually, this is a good question. I think you kind of just answered it there. And at the beginning of your presentation, you dealt with it. Eduardo asks, is visualization for the masses? And it certainly sounds like it, right? It can be useful for pretty much anyone in any walk of life.
Yeah, I think visualization is for the masses. It definitely is when we look at things like election maps or weather maps or the weather chart, that you bring up on your phone that you're looking at every day. So it is for the masses already when we're looking at numerical data. I think looking at textual data, we're maybe 20 years behind where we are with numerical data. And so maybe 20 years from now, we will be seeing more and more text visualizations. And you already see a little bit of them popping up. So in the presidential debates, if you look at the New York Times, they've done visualizations of the words that were used in the debates and what are the common words used by the debaters versus what are the polarizing words that they use and so forth. So it is getting there, give it time.
Excellent. And actually, since you're sharing your screen, if I can put you on the spot, can you put up my favorite slide, which is the one of the movie costumes throughout the years? Do you have that handy or no?
Yes, I do have that. That's a couple slides away.
And actually, that leads to my question for you. I mean, I know you're coming at this from an analytical angle, from an academic angle, but do you ever just look at a data visualization and just absolutely appreciate it for the aesthetics. Just like, wow, that's gorgeous.
Oh, absolutely. There's books with very analytical data visualizations, and there are books with, you know, just beautiful visualizations. Here, I'll promote somebody else's book. This is Data Sketches by Nadia Bremer and Shirley Wu. And they just, you know, make things that look aesthetically, amazing and wonderful. So yes, there are times when I can just really strongly appreciate the aesthetics, and there's a whole subgenre, if you will, in data visualization of people who are really, really good at making good looking visualizations. And then with regards to your question about the dresses, this is an interesting one I find fascinating. It had never even occurred to me it would be the kind of analysis that somebody could do. And this is a snapshot of the dress on Alice from each of the different movies from like 18, or maybe I guess this is the illustrations. The illustrations or movies? I don't know. I can't blow it up right now, unfortunately. But we've got all the different dresses of Alice throughout all the different ages, right? And it's actually kind of interesting, right? Like that she does go modern in some dresses, but then, you know, kind of retro in some other dresses. And some are very juvenile and some are more adult.
I gotta say, I recognize, yeah, I think this is, they included theater productions as well, because I recognize the overalls right away. That was Meryl Streep in Alice in the Palace, or I think it had a few different titles, but she was in an off-Broadway show. She and Mark Lynn Baker from Perfect Strangers. But yeah, that's the one in the middle there, the coveralls, the only one that's not addressed. But yeah, I just love that. And I went to the person's website, I saw like she sells it as a poster. I'm kind of tempted, I have to say. All right, we have a few more questions here. Oh yeah, this one. Maybe this one you can just add to your list if you haven't seen it. Mark Burstein says that Martin Gardner wrote an article for our Night Letter. That's our newsletter, Richard, that comes out twice a year, about the use of the phrases you know, you see, and of course in the Alex books, with reference to a chart by James B. Hobbs tabulating the characters and the occurrences of the phrase. Are you familiar with that one? Did you come across
that? I'm not, but I will go look for it now, shortly hereafter, and bump up the number to 65.
Excellent. Let's see here. This is from Anonymous. They didn't want to be known. Very interesting and engaging presentation. Thank you. Do you know if any current writers are using this type of data visualization to assist in their own writing process? They must be interested in some of these surprising results, for example, the connections between characters, et cetera.
So I think there's some really interesting people experimenting with text and writing text and generating text, because you can get computers to generate text now, as I was already talking. And you can have fun using the computer to try to create stories, that the computer be part of the authoring process in there, using some of these tools, and then also use visualization in combination with that. And I would say one of my favorites there is Lynn Cherney, who's very active on Twitter and occasionally posts some amazingly riotous visualization outcomes of different things that she has created. For me, the riotous part is the riotous visualization that comes out from some of her experiments that she does. And so that would be one. She hasn't focused on Alice in particular, and she's not actively focused on like creating best-selling fiction. Mm-hmm. You'd have to to look for other authors for that.
You know, I'm going to go to a question you asked, actually, because it really got me thinking, what would Carol do if he had the tools available that we have today in terms of data visualization? And as Daniel Rover Singer pointed out in the chat, he did do The Mouse's Tail, which is, of course, a poem in the shape of the tail. But yeah, your question got me thinking, because he did love gadgets, but a man of contrast at the same time, when the wet collodial process became obsolete for photography, he was just kind of like, I'm out. It's too easy now. Anybody can do it. So yeah, I think that's a fascinating, I don't know, not that you can debate it, but a fascinating topic for discussion. Actually, maybe we can talk about that in the social hour, everybody. We've got a few more questions here, but I am going to put the link to our social hour in the chat right now. And it's also in the email. If you're on our email list, you got that yesterday. But yeah, when we're done here, we can all discuss this a little further. And Richard, I don't know if you can join us at all for that, but I'm sure people would love to pick your brain in person as well. And just a few more questions here. Kira Vaklovic, who I know is loving that slide of the Alice stresses, the emotional landscape of the text is fascinating. Is one of the limitations of this method the fact that it depends on labeling or tagging, whereby only one emotion is attributed? Sometimes Alice, for instance, seems to be feeling a whole range of emotions. And she also says, thank you for a great talk, which I'm sure everyone else seconds that emotion.
Well, thank you. So emotion is an interesting one. So how do you calculate sentiment? How do you calculate emotion is part of, I think, that question. I'll just show this snapshot here that maybe is coming through the camera.
Well, actually, you're still sharing your screen, so that's extra time.
I'm still sharing my screen, so it's really extra time. Let's stop sharing the screen.
There we go.
And let's go back to this. So there's different ways to calculate emotion. The simplest way is to find a word list where you've got the emotions associated with those words, that people have done that statistical analysis, or they've done some other means of finding the associations with those words. So this was a visualization that I had created that's in the book that's just showing, you can see in there, there's the word like joy. Maybe it's blurry, maybe it's coming through. And then there's a bunch of words around joy, and there's some words around anticipation. And then anger, we've got a couple of words there, and disgust. And in between the words anger and disgust, there's a couple of smaller words. So they're actually associated with two different emotions. And so they would get counted, if that word occurred, it would get counted for both anger and for disgust. So I think there we've got like lying is associated with both anger and disgust, for example. And there's some words that are in the middle of this plot here that are, they're just associated with many, many different emotions. So that's how it works in the most simplest example. And there's more advanced ones, more advanced techniques. What I'm doing, you know, as my focus is on visualization, not on the text processing. I'm using the simplest ones that are available because I can understand them, I can implement them. They're within the realms of what I can do. So that's how I did the emotions.
Thank you. And we have a funny comment in the chat here. I just bought data sketches. Richard should get a commission.
Oh.
And we have one more question here in the Q&A. Let's see. It's a long one. Everybody starts off by thanking you effusively. So that I'll skip that part if you don't mind. My question is this. I'm sure the members of the LCSNA know of many a fine edition of Alice in Wonderland, but from a purely data visualization perspective, is there a text source that you would recommend above all others? For example, a source that would need the least amount of data conversion and cleaning.
So when I'm processing the text for Alice and using programming to extract these things, I'm just using the text from Project Gutenberg. As I have noticed that there are multiple different editions of Alice on Project Gutenberg, and you would be, it's a problem if you, I ran into problems when I used different editions and different patterns came out, and I'm going like, how come these things aren't lining up? So novice mistake perhaps, and somebody who's not an expert in Lewis Carroll and being aware of the many different editions. But no, I just use the versions from Gutenberg, and if the person who created the transcriptions on Gutenberg made errors, then those errors are in my analyses.
Got it. And as we discussed yesterday when we had our meet and greet, that Project Gutenberg, Alice was the first non-Bible text, is that right, that they uploaded? I believe it was, I believe it was their first novel for sure. That was
it's one of the very early ones.
Yeah.
So again, it points to the popularity of Alice and a good reason for choosing Alice. Yet another good reason for choosing Alice.
Yet another, yes. Never out of print. And I'm just a little distracted by the chat here, but yeah, I think we've covered all the major questions here. I want to thank you so much, Richard. I really enjoyed this. Like I said, I really think we need to do a screening because everyone, it will be on YouTube later, a week or two from now, most likely. But yeah, I'm sure everyone just had so many comments as they were going through. And presentations like this, they're just easy, like Sunday morning for me, appropriately. But you know, I just get to introduce you and then listen to this wonderful talk and relay the questions. So thank you so much. And if you have time, we would love to see you at the social hour. Everyone, I'm going to go ahead and stick that in the chat once again. And I always recommend jotting down that meeting ID because, you know, I tend to end things abruptly and then people miss the link there. But thank you so much for joining us, everyone. And hopefully we'll see most of you at the social hour. Thank you, Richard.
Thank you. Bye-bye, everybody. Thanks very much.
Frost on the ground, daisy chain crown.